It's not merely that we're not alone, but we have never been alone.
In 1947, the Air Technical Intelligence Center at Dayton, the top Air Force intelligence men and scientists under contract, sent a secret document to the commanding general of the Air Force saying that whatever these things were, they were real.
What happens next is that a new object appears from behind the clouds. It was not identified. The new object suddenly descends and disappears into the clouds. Once again, here is the American plane at the same altitude as the moon. And now here is the object as it appears behind the F-16. And here it emerges from the F-16, then goes down and enters the cloud, which is visible here as a large, cylindrical-shaped object. And as the Russian planes close in, the UFO suddenly picks up speed and disappears. Here it is once again. You'll notice the cylinder seems to be traveling at about the same speed as the MiGs until about here. And then it seems to increase its speed, which, according to pilots, must have reached at least Mach 3 in about 10 seconds.
Astronomical view today is that probably any star in the sky that you would look at probably has one habitable planet.
The news of the world, Wednesday, February 25th. Once again, Columbia's correspondents in world capitals and in the fighting zones in the Western Pacific are ready to give you the latest news direct by shortwave radio.
And now for news of our own West Coast, we take you to Los Angeles and the report of Byron Palmer.
Anti-aircraft guns went into action against unidentified aircraft in the Los Angeles area shortly after 3 a.m. Pacific wartime this morning. The anti-aircraft guns began barking during a blackout ordered by the 4th Interceptor Command at 2:25 a.m. The unidentified object, which some sources thought might be a blimp, moved slowly down the Pacific coast from Santa Monica and disappeared south of Long Beach. Army officials declined to comment on the possibility that the object might have been a blimp. However, it required nearly 30 minutes to travel some 25 miles, far slower than an airplane. Watchers on the rooftop of the Columbia Broadcasting Building in the heart of Hollywood could plainly see the flashes of guns and searchlights sweeping the skies in a wide arc along the coastal area. Concussion of the shells could be felt in downtown Los Angeles, 15 miles away. U.S. Army planes quickly took to the dark skies, but whether they contacted the object has not been announced. Army officials say they will not comment until they receive a full report of the action. Although some watchers say they saw airplanes in the air, semi-official sources say they probably were the U.S. Army's pursuit. Several observers say they saw one or more planes spotlighted by 20 or 30 searchlights. The object moved southward, presumably over Huntington Park at the western edge of Los Angeles, and on southward to about Long Beach on the coast. By 3:30 a.m., observers said the object appeared to be over the south of Long Beach. Searchlights closely followed the object down the coast and kept it centered in their glare. Shells frequently could be seen bursting near the object, but none appeared to hit it. The shooting stopped about 3:30 a.m. The shooting brought warfare to the front door of this city of 1.25 million population for the first time since December 7th. Already, it was alert to the presence off the Southern California coast of a Japanese submarine, which had pumped 25 shells into an oil field north of Santa Barbara Monday evening. Because of the presence of the submarine, a three-hour alert was ordered at dusk last night, and civilian authorities stood at their posts while the Army and Navy continued their search for the submersible. The evening alert ended at 10:23 p.m., but another was sounded at 2:22 a.m., and the blackout followed within 3 minutes. It covered Los Angeles County from Santa Monica supermoon. At 2:27, all Southern California radio stations were ordered off the air, except those in San Diego. Approximately 20 minutes after the firing died down, the ship returned and headed westward from Long Beach toward Santa Monica. The guns went into action again, hurling round after round of shells at the object. The second barrage appeared to be closer to downtown Los Angeles, since watchers could hear the concussion of the guns more clearly and the flash of bursting shells was brighter. Then the ship disappeared for the second time over the ocean. We return you now to CBS in New York.
We got round vehicles that fly around high-speed airplanes that can stop dead, that can make right-angle turns and do it without noise, without visible external engines, without wings and without tails. We could build things that look like that, but not look like that and fly like that. If we could, we'd have used them in all the wars we've had in the last 50 years.
Well, at about 2:15, I took off from Chehalis, Washington, en route to Yakima, and of course, every time that any of us fly over the country near Mount Rainier, we spend an hour or two in search of the marine plane that's never been found that they believe is in the snow someplace southwest of that particular area. That area is located at about, or its elevation is about 10,000 foot, and I had made one sweep in close to Mount Rainier and down one of the canyons and was dragging it for any types of objects that might prove to be the marine ship. And as I come out of the canyon there, it was about 15 minutes. I was approximately 25 to 28 miles from Mount Rainier. I climbed back up to 9,200 feet, and I noticed to the left of me a chain which looked to me like the tail of a Chinese kite, kind of weaving and going at a terrific speed across the face of Mount Rainier. I at first thought they were geese because it flew like geese, but it was going so fast that I immediately changed my mind and decided it was a bunch of new jet planes in formation. Well, as the planes come to the edge of Mount Rainier, flying at about 160 degrees south, I thought I would clock them because it was such a clear day, and I didn't know where their destination was, but due to the fact that I had Mount St. Helens and Mount Adams to clock them by, I just thought I'd see just how fast they were going, since among pilots we argue about speed so much. And they seemed to flip and flash in the sun just like a mirror. And in fact, I happened to be at an angle from the sun that seemed to hit the tops of these peculiar-looking things in such a way that it almost blinded you when you looked at them through your plexiglass windshield. Well, it was about 1 minute to three when I started clocking them on my sweep second-hand clock. And as I kept looking at them, I kept looking for their tails. They didn't have any tails. I thought, well, maybe something's wrong with my eyes. And I turns the plane around and opens the window and looks out the window, and sure enough, I couldn't find any tails on them. And the whole observation of these particular ships didn't last more than about 2.5 minutes, and I could see them only plainly when they seemed to tip their wing or whatever it was, and the sun flashed on them. They looked something like a pie plate that was cut in half with a sort of a convex triangle in the rear. Now, I thought, well, that maybe they're jet planes with just the tail painted green or brown or something, and didn't think too much of it, but kept on watching them. They didn't fly in the conventional formation that's taught in our Army. They seemed to kind of weave in and out right.